It is what it is. What can I say? So if we look at plans for the week ahead, there will be no office hours this week because the secretary will be on vacation, and Pastor James will not be back until Friday. So if there's any pressing needs, you can always call me, or and we can get you in touch with the right people. So today after church, the youth ensemble will rehearse. Correct, Beth, you want to talk about that a little bit?
Ensemble will meet down in the fellowship hall. We'll meet until 11:45. So whenever church is over, as soon as I get my stuff packed up and down there, that's when we'll start. There is no youth. The musical ensemble will not meet next week because it's the church picnic. And then parents, if you're bringing kids, I have calendars down there for the up through Christmas. All right, so I can give you a calendar for that. And then church choir this week is on Tuesday as normal, not on Monday as in the bulletin. So church choir is on Tuesday.
Thank you, Beth.
Yep.
And today we have a special offering for our mortgage. And anything that comes in that special offering, we can put right on the principal of our mortgage. When we remortgage the church with Jim Thorpe National Bank, they allowed us to do that. It's an open-end mortgage. Who we were dealing with before, they would not let us put it on the principal. So that's a wonderful thing. So we can get that mortgage. And I think after we remortgaged, it was for $130,000, and we're down to like $126,000 now. So it doesn't take long, and it comes down. So if Monday is the first day of preschool, and Karen Weaver she's so excited. And if you look at the fellowship hall, she has it ready to go. She has 43 pupils this year. 43. She had to turn some away. And that's amazing. And it, as everyone knows, it is our preschool, you know, and she's the director of it. Girl Scouts, Monday at 6. Tuesday, like Beth said, is chancel choir rehearsal. Friday, AA Back to Basics in the Grove. Sunday, faith formation at 9, worship service in the Grove and the church picnic. Oh my God, we're so excited for the church picnic. Mary and Joe, we were talking about it, and we're just over the top. So please come out and join us. It's going to be a wonderful time.
And please bring family or friends.
We'd love
to make it grow.
Absolutely. And there's sign-up sheets in the back if you want to bring something. But the church is providing the turkey barbecue and the hot dogs. And like Beth said, there will be no youth ensemble rehearsal next week. Are there any first-time guests with us this week? Raise your hand. Thank you. Upcoming events, of course, September 19th, our church picnic, and the youth ensemble is starting, and Beth talked about that. If you'd like to sponsor a guest musician, just like Patty Ditzel, who we had come in and play the violin this summer, we are going to look for other people to come in and do special music for special services. Patty is going to be back for our Thanksgiving service, and she will also be doing one of the services on Christmas Eve. So if you'd like to donate to that, it's $25 we're asking, you know, and you can sponsor those special music programs. Pastor James is taking names for the new confirmation class. He's excited. I think he has two already. So, and right now we have, how many are in confirmation right now? No, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, so the script orders go in today, and we'll have the cards for you next Sunday. If you have any questions, there's order forms at the back, and I'll be here at the end to answer any questions, too. But we'll have those next Sunday.
Thank you, Monica. Any of you would like to keep the youth of our congregation in our prayers? If you know anyone that's away at college or in the military and we need to put them in our prayer list, please let us know or call the church office. The fundraising is having a pork and sauerkraut dinner takeout only Saturday, October 30th. The pickup will be from 2 to 5. It's $10 for a dinner, and it will be pork, sauerkraut, mashed potatoes, applesauce, and homemade dessert. So you can call the church office and get your reservation in for that. We are also having basket social walk-in, and it will be Friday, 10:22, 3 to 7, and Saturday, 10:23, 12 to 4. And I know Bonnie's looking for people. To contribute baskets for the social. And the baskets, we're asking for a value of $20. If you don't want to get a basket together, you can give a monetary amount, anything, and give it to Bonnie, and she will take care of that to look for. This is one of the baskets that's going to be at the basket social. Wonderful. Thank you, Bonnie, for all you do. So, we have a giveaway today. All the things in the back there, old electronics, please, whoever wants them, take them. They've been sitting over in a room for, I don't know, 2 years now, and I need the room for a classroom. Isn't that a wonderful thing? We need it for a Sunday school classroom. So, anything in the back there, if you look at it, take it, please. And our guest preacher today is Reverend Randy Lentz, and he's been with us numerous times before, and like I said, Pastor James is on vacation, and he's taken an extended vacation because on his last vacation, he came back for, I think, 2 funerals, and so he needs the time off, so that's wonderful. Anniversaries, Kevin and Tina Minnick, I don't see them here. Birthdays. Michelle Schreinhold, I don't see her here. Dean Middle, he's not here as well. Is there anyone else celebrating an anniversary or a birthday this week that's here in the church? Well, we wish everyone a happy anniversary and a happy birthday. Any other announcements for the good of the church? If not, let's prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of God. Thank you.
Grace and peace to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us worship God in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise, those that are able, and join me in this morning's call to worship. Look at the heavens.
They are shining the glory of God.
The days and the nights declare the magnificence of God's creative works.
Their voice goes through all the earth, and their words reach the ends of the world.
Let our words of praise be acceptable to you.
Our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer.
And now let us sing together our opening hymn number 22, All Creatures of Our God and King.
In the name of Messiah, we pray. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, the living Word, we are forgiven. Live in peace.
Amen.
And now, let us say together our statement of faith.
As members of the Christian Church, we believe in God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Holy God, whose Spirit comes to us in moments of both strength and weakness, come now into our midst that we might be able to hear your word in fullness and in truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I will read from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 41 and 45. When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you, but whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to serve, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
So, this morning's reading might be a little misleading if you're not really full immersed in some of the gospel lessons, or if, let's show of hands, or let's put it this way, show of hands, who did not read the lesson for this morning before they got here? Probably just about everybody, okay? So, does everybody fully understand why the other 10 disciples were a little ticked off at James and John? It's because, according to whichever scripture you read, either James and John approached Jesus and said, Hey, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, one of us would like to sit on your left hand, and the other one of us would like to sit on your right hand. Now, that's according to the Gospel of Mark. If you go into the Gospel of St. Matthew, guess who came to Jesus on behalf of James and John? Their mother. Mom's looking out for her boys. Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, how about if one of my boys sits on your left and one of my boys sits on your right hand? Now, it seems like both of them are making some grand assumptions here and maybe a little bit full of themselves. But hold the phone. A little bit of explanation. You see, I did a little more reading. If we return to the first chapter of Mark, verse 19, Jesus is walking down the shore, and first he comes upon Simon, better known to us now as Peter, and his brother Andrew, and says, "Hey guys, come along with me, and I'll make you fishers of men." So they get up and they leave. He walks down the shore a little bit further, and who does he come upon but a man by the name of Zebedee, who has two sons. Can anybody guess what his two sons' names are?
John.
Yeah, okay, so they're number 3 and 4, and they're probably within 5 minutes of being invited of Peter and Andrew. These four guys have been with Jesus since the very beginning. All right, so we go a little bit further, and we find out that when Peter's mother-in-law was sick, we all remember the story, and Jesus came to the house, and he went in and laid hands on her, and immediately she was healed, and he got up and started making them something to eat, right? That's what all mothers do. They don't feel good, they feel a little bit better, and they do what? They make food, they feed us, right? Guess there? James and John. We go a little bit further down to the fifth chapter of Mark, verse 37. And we remember that a man by the name of Jairus, a leader of the synagogue, approached Jesus and said, "My daughter is sick. If you just simply come to my house, you can heal her." And Jesus gets delayed by the woman who grabs Jesus' garment, and the power goes out, remember, and she was healed. And they come and say, "Don't bother the master any longer. Your daughter is dead." And Jesus says, "She's not dead. She's only sleeping." Jesus walked into the room, laid hands on the little girl, and said, "Get up." And the little girl got up. And guess who was with Jesus? Peter, Andrew, James, and John. In the ninth chapter of Mark, in the second verse, it's the story of the Transfiguration. We remember Jesus went up on the mountain, and two guys appeared and were talking with Jesus, Elijah and Moses. And guess who was with Jesus? Peter, James, and John. And then in the 13th chapter of Mark, Jesus tells the disciples that he is going to, in 3 days, the temple will be totally destroyed. This massive temple in Jerusalem, all these stones, not one will be left on another. And Jesus takes off and goes over to the other side to the Mount of Olives, and they're sitting there, and their discussion begins about how this is going to happen. And guess who Jesus is having this discussion with? Peter, Andrew, James, and John. Are you starting to see a pattern, folks? And then, in the 14th chapter of Mark, the 33rd verse, this is taking place now right after Jesus had been instituted communion, he celebrated the Last Supper, and he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, and there was four people with him. And he said, "Stay here and pray while I go on a little further." Jesus was praying just prior to his betrayal, his arrest, and subsequent crucifixion. And guess who was with him? Peter, Andrew, James, and John. So, it kind of changes the atmosphere and the attitude about the request, doesn't it? Because these guys have been there at all the crucial moments in Jesus' life, or if not all of them, a vast majority, and some very, very special moments. Now, those aren't the words that are so important, at least not to me in this lesson, because Jesus is saying, "Look, I know you've been with me, but who sits at my left-hand side and who sits at my right-hand side isn't mine to decide, but rather that belongs to the Father." That's the same Jesus who prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Lord, if it be your will, take this cup from me, but not my will, but thy will be done." So the real lesson in this scripture this morning, at least what stuck in my mind, what gnawed at my conscience, what stuck in my heart, were Jesus' words that, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants, but it is not so among you." What Jesus is saying is, "Look, folks, I know you've been with me from the beginning. I know you've been with me through thick and thin. But that doesn't get you any kind of special compensation or special place, at least not in the natural order of things. Because if you want to be somebody's leader, you need to be their servant." Now, I know in the day and the age that we live in, and the things that are going on in our world, it's hard to imagine somebody who has that kind of power and that kind of authority saying, "Hey, you know what? I here to serve you and really mean it. I mean, let's face it, political elections. We get promised everything we want, right? Everything under the sun. They're going to fix it all. They're going to make it all better. And it's all a bunch of bull. Because one person can't make it better, folks. One person can try to lead people in a direction. But if we do it by force, if you do it by inciting or promising people things to gain their favor, all you're doing is digging a bigger hole. It's when we start thinking about what is best, not just for me, but for everyone. How do I make it better for you and you and you and you and all of you and everybody in God's world? Because the decisions that each of us make each and every day don't just affect us. Decisions I make affect my wife, the decisions that I make at home. And sometimes I make some good ones. And sometimes not so good. Ask her, she'll tell you. She'll probably be glad to tell you all about it. The decisions that I made at work. In the back of my mind, I'm always thinking about the 18 or 20 people that I employ. Because the things that I determine and the things that I put into place don't just affect me, but it affects my employees. And the success of our business affects their families. And the decisions I make affect our customers and their families. Just, you see what's happening? It's like throwing that little stone into the pond. And the ripple starts, and it just reverberates and spreads and spreads and spreads. And so it is with the decisions that you and I make each and every day. Now, I gotta be honest with you. When you look at the world we live in, when you watch the world of politics and what's going on in Washington, I'm going to be honest with you folks, I don't care what party, and we're not getting into that. I'm just saying, as a general rule, you got to wonder, what are these people thinking, and what are they really concerned about? Are they concerned about the welfare of us all? Or are they so concerned about keeping their position of power, keeping their position of authority, keeping their position of influence, that they're making decisions that are not necessarily good for the vast majority of people in our country, or possibly even in the world? Decisions of who we're going to give aid to and how we're going to give that aid. You know, doesn't it boggle your mind sometimes when papers are released, you know, 10 years, 15 years after, and you come to realize who exactly did what with whom, and you go, what on earth were they thinking? But it's nothing new on the face of the earth. Think about this. We're going to go back to some United States history. We fought a war with England to gain our independence, right? And who was the general that led our armies? Anybody remember? The space is on our $1 bill. Yeah, go ahead.
George Washington.
George Washington. And do you remember what happened after we had gained our freedom? What was the cry from the people? What did they ask for? What did they ask George Washington to become?
President.
No. First, before he became president, they asked him to be
king.
A king, the very thing he just fought a war to get rid of, and they wanted to make him a king. Had it not been for the integrity and the wisdom and the knowledge of George Washington, they'd have gone back to the same form of government they had just gotten himself freed from. But the same history repeats itself, because if you remember, after God freed the Israelites from Egypt, brought them out of Egypt, placed judges over them, And then what did they cry out for sometime later? They wanted a king just like all the other nations had. And they had some good kings. Problem is, they also had some very bad kings, and even the good kings had some problems. King David, one of the most famous kings, a man after God's own heart, polluted his own house with his betrayal of another man's wife, and then hid that betrayal, that adultery, when he found out she was pregnant. Brought the man home, tried to get him to sleep with his wife so they could claim the child was his. And when that finally didn't work, sent him back into battle with orders to put him in the fiercest fighting and withdraw and allow him to be killed to cover his sin. Not one of his finest moments, folks. None of us may have made those kind of mistakes. Maybe some of us have. It's immaterial. Because we have been fortunate enough to be granted a Savior, God's Son, Jesus Christ. See, He came to earth to forgive us our sins, but in order to really be forgiven and to really have take full advantage of that gift of redemption, we also have to repent of those sins and then not do those again. We have to learn from the teaching and from the life that Jesus lived what we are to do. Now, how many of us here feel like being somebody else's servant? It's not always fun being somebody's servant, is it? Because people don't always appreciate when you're doing the best thing for them, do they? People don't always appreciate when you're trying to put rules in place to keep them safe. Ask any teenage kid about parents' rules. They don't like them. It's not that the parents are trying to do harm or trying to restrict them or trying to keep them from having some enjoyment. Good parents put rules in place because they don't want to see their children come to harm. They are trying to protect them. And that's the same thing God does for us. He's put rules in place. And all we need to do is follow those rules. Now, it doesn't mean life's going to be perfect because we're going to be, you know, all of us, we know people that don't live by the rules, right? And sometimes their inability to follow those rules, the after effects spill over onto us. But we do not suffer the same consequences as the people that just blatantly disregard those rules. See, here's where it really gets tough, because one of the things I think that I've learned over the last several years is that, yes, Jesus came and He died and He took away our sin. But we have to make a choice that either we're going to continue sinning and hurting ourselves and hurting those we love and hurting people that we may not even know, or we can begin to follow the teachings of Jesus Christ more closely each and every day. And we can find a better way of life for ourselves, for our families, and yes, if enough of us follow those teachings, we can change the lives of people throughout the world by serving that meal, giving that cup of water, giving aid where it's needed. Just had an example out here in the parking lot this morning. A young man found a dog running stray and brought it here, made some phone calls, contacted the owner, and the owner, if not already, is soon going to be reunited with his owner. He was being somebody's servant. And I gotta tell you, he walked in and he said, "I'm not sure really what to do because I don't really go to church." And I said, "That's okay. These are really nice people, and you're welcome here any Sunday morning." They
going to be back. Maybe he won't. Maybe God sent him here today in this place to show us an example. I invited him to say, because he said, you just made my sermon. But I show and tell again. Folks, there's opportunities each and every day that come our way to make a difference. And sometimes it can just be a small thing. I tell you what, let me give you a challenge. The next time you wind up going to a Turkey Hill or a 7-Eleven or Speedway, you know, one of those little grocery Minute Mart, you know, gas station and all that kind of thing, and you go in to pay or make your purchase and leave, as somebody approaches the door, open the door for them, smile at them, and tell them to have a nice day. You'll be amazed. I usually find it's one of two things. They either smile back and say, thank you, you have a good day too, or you stand there in utter disbelief and don't know what to say. They're totally dumbfounded that somebody gave them a greeting and a smile. Either way, you've just changed a life for the better. And it's the small things that sometimes matter the most. My hope for you is that you found something in this message this morning, that something has triggered some thought process that I haven't put you to sleep. That somewhere this week, you will find the opportunity to do something even small, but special to another human being. And you will be reminded about this message. And you will be reminded each and every day of the love that God shows through us to others because of his Son, Jesus Christ. God bless you all. Amen.
thanks to her, our young pianist. She does an excellent job. She plays beautifully. We thank you for that gift. But being able to, as individuals, lift our voices in praise, I think is something that is very, very special. And so I really, truly thank God for that gift that we are now able to once again offer. And I think that God is also grateful to be able to hear that. So, again, many thanks. Are there any prayer requests this morning?
Nope. I have one. My son Spencer leaves for the Air Force tomorrow for basic training. There, he's got it. He's got it. Awesome. So.
Thank you for the reminder.
Yeah.
Yes. Special blessings on all of our folks involved in the military. Yes.
My great niece, Christy Purcell. She's out in California. It's the first time she's taking her own naval ship out to sea. She'll be gone for 6 months, leaving her family behind.
And it's Christy Purcell?
Yes.
Joys this morning? No. All right. If not, then let us prepare our hearts and our minds to come before God in this time of prayer. Most holy God, so loving, so gracious, so kind, so forgiving, Lord, with many manifold gifts that you shed upon us are just too numerous to mention. And Lord, we confess that there are so many that we even fail to recognize. But Lord, help us to always be thankful for those gifts, those that we recognize and those that we really appreciate, and those that we sometimes forget and take for granted. Lord, help us to understand that not everyone is as blessed as we are. Not everyone shares the same freedoms that we have. Not everyone has a home in which to live, or food to eat, or places to go for medical care. Lord, help us to value these things more than we do, and help us to learn to be more appreciative. And even more importantly, Lord, help us to learn how to better share the gifts that you have given. Father, we lift up our country, and we just ask for healing, as so many people are seeking their justice, as so many people are seeking to be recognized in the way that they deem best. Lord, help us all to realize that we are all in this world together, that we're all brothers and sisters here regardless of our ethnicity, the color of our skin, or any other orientation that we claim to be ours. Because, Lord, you created us all, and you made us all different in very special ways. And it's when we begin to value and celebrate and utilize those gifts that we are at our best, that we are at our finest, that we are receiving the best blessings that you have to offer. Perhaps, Lord, we're even rejecting blessings when we reject other people. Help us to learn and to grow. Lord, we pray for the world in which we live, a world that is unsettled, a world where challenges arise each and every day, a world in which domination seems to be preeminent to caring for or providing for people's needs,
nation 20 years ago and the attack that it endured. An attack on our own soil, which has changed us in so many different ways. An attack that robbed us of our innocence. An attack that sometimes puts our freedoms on hold in certain situations and in various areas. An attack that has somehow made life more difficult for us. An attack that left many innocent people dead. We pray for their souls. We pray for the families left behind, Lord, in the loss of those loved ones. Lord, we pray for the families of those on that ill-fated flight that crashed in the western part of our state. People who saw evil at work and did what they needed to do to minimize the loss from that attack as well. Lord, may we always remember the sacrifices made. May we learn well from those brave folk what it means to be true servants of other people. Lord God, we lift up those in our military, our first responders, those in the medical field, as they come to our rescue in whatever situation comes our way. We ask your blessing upon them and pray that you would keep them safe. Today, Lord, we in particular lift up Spencer Perkins and Christy Purcell as they pursue their careers in our military, preparing to defend our nation. Lord, we pray that they would be well equipped, that they would be well prepared, and that wherever they go, Lord, that you go with them. And Lord, we lift up Marie Dieter, who is now FED Home with Hospice Care. And Lord, we pray that she would be peaceful and that her passing would come quickly. We also lift up her family during this extremely difficult time and pray that you would fill them with your peace. Lord God, we lift all these things to you in and through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who taught us to pray to you, saying these words: Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Folks, God has given us the Son and made us stewards of all creation. God has given us our lives and our very beings. And in response, we bring our gifts we have received from praying that we might continue the ministry God calls us to do in Christ's name. Amen. This morning's offering will now be gathered.
Yeah.
the God who made you, loved you, and lives with you, bring you to a faith that cannot be weighed down, and a courage that knows no bounds. We will now sing together our final hymn, number 192, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Spirit guiding you and leading you all the days of your life.